If you listen to the critics, if you listen to your own doubts and call them reasons, you may never find the drive to go back to school. But a little change in direction, a new perspective, and the right program may make your successful new path a reality. The Accelerated Degree Program at Albright College. Start your degree or complete your degree one night a week in as little as 2 years. Albright College, a different way of thinking.
Good evening and welcome to the regular edition of Local Government in Berks. I'm your host, Paul Janssen, Director for the Center of Excellence in Local Government and the Berks County Water and Sewer Association. I need to send a special thanks to Albright College for their commitment to CELG for over 22 years in our operations. Purpose of the program is to assist our viewers in a better understanding of some of the key issues facing our local communities. I want to take a moment to thank our premier sponsors for the Center for Excellence in Local Government, as they're a major part of why the center can operate in the way that we do and provide the programs for the citizens of Berks County. These sponsors are SSM, EHD, Kozloff Stout, the Greater Reading Economic Partnership, and our newest sponsor, Hartman Valeriano, McGovern and Lutz. I also want to send a special thank you to BCTV for providing the opportunity for local government in Berks to be a viable program. And finally, a special thanks to the Berks County Commissioners for their financial commitment to the operations of CELG and the Berks County Water and Sewer Association. Today, our program is going to be in a slightly different format. Tonight, we are going to have a holiday conversation with Mayor-elect Wally Scott as he prepares to begin his administration as the mayor for the city of Reading. I'm extremely excited about the opportunity that's before us for the city and also the leadership that I believe Wally will bring to the city. So real quickly, I want to say thank you for coming to the show, Wally, and I'm looking forward to spending a little bit of time in this holiday season talking to the residents and the citizens of Reading, and I welcome you to the show.
Thank you very much.
Wally, you know, let's talk a little bit about, I know that you've been a resident of the city of Reading your entire life in various locations and times and how you've gone through. But I'd like to wind this back a little bit. It's been an interesting election. At times it's been a little bit tough. But let's go back and talk a little bit about how you arrived at where you are and just about ready to face a four-year term as the mayor of Reading.
Well, obviously I campaigned for it, okay? And I retired as a district judge in December of last year, and I retired because of the fact that I wanted the opportunity to run and serve the people of the city of Reading as mayor. I felt that I could do a great job for you, and there was a lot of things that were coming into my courts that I felt ordinances that really weren't voted on or made because of the fact that it would do something to help the city. It seemed like it was a lot of ordinances that were made to make money and were passed to make money. So that sort of bothered me, and many times I wished that I could just step off the bench, go over to City Hall and say, you know, why are you passing these ordinances? Mm-hmm. And in all those years that I served there, I saw little by little how government took more control of people and they were no longer service oriented. And when we went into Act 47, I, like everyone else, you know, being a citizen of the city of Reading, was careful to wonder, why are we here, what put us here, and what's the possibility of us going bankrupt? It didn't take me long to realize that Act 47 is in place strictly to save the government, not the people. And I decided that, who's here representing the people then? And so I decided I'd like to represent the people and take you all on a journey with me, okay, to how we can save the people of the city of Reading first. And in saving the people of the city of Reading, we obviously save our government. So here I am today. I won the primary election. That was a tough election. I had not ran for a citywide office in 30-some years. And so I was very fortunate that I was able to serve the public for such a long time as a district judge, given 21, almost 22 years. And I think that those years of service are what gave me the credibility, plus my love for the people of our community and our city.
You were actually born in Reading, and you lived your whole life as you were growing up. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well,
People need to see there's a side of you that I think people need to see, and I think it's a really good part of your background and preparing you to for public service here in the city.
Well, I was born in 1951, a long time ago, and I was in where AmeriCorp College is today. They have what's called Francis Hall, and that was St. Francis Orphanage, and that's where I lived for 7 years. Uh-huh. Okay, I went in there when I was 7 months old. And was there till 7 years, and the orphanage itself closed in 1957-58, I believe. And then I went home and met my family, my parents, and stuff like that. But I don't want you to think I was an orphan. I wasn't an orphan.
Yeah.
I'm Catholic, love being a Catholic, very interested in my faith and where we go. And I certainly love my parents, who have since passed away, were great people. A lot of people knew them. They had a small restaurant on South 9th Street. It was called Scotty's, and I worked in the restaurant. So I learned my first public service was waiting on people, washing dishes, peeling potatoes, short order cook, waiting on tables and stuff. And I got to know the community, and I lived in a time when you had policemen on every corner, you had call boxes, and you had stores that were open to everyone. You could walk Penn Street. There was a lot going on there. But more than that, you could go out into other neighborhoods besides that, and life was great. And the opportunities were, there for anyone, including young people who were out shoveling snow or cleaning up or being, stock boys or stock girls in different stores that were downtown. I remember just about all the stores, and my claim to fame at that time was I probably had all the snow contracts to shovel all the pavements in the wintertime. So I'm ready for any snow that comes along. And I'm used to shoveling. But I went through the Reading school system. Well, I did the first couple of years at St. Francis Orphanage, and then I went to a Manus Dowd school, then went to Southern Junior High, and then to Reading High. Graduated in 69. And then I moved on, did a small stint at Penn State, which was over where McDonald's is. In Wyomissing now, that was the old Textile Machine Works office building there. Incidentally, in my 12th year of school, I worked 11-7 shift at Textile Machine Works, and I drove a forklift truck. So I used to go work there from 11 to 7, take a shower, and then walk up to Reading High. And I don't say that as though people shouldn't take a bus. I just think about looking back. I guess I was always fortunate. I always had a job. I was always in a position that I got to meet people. So while I was in high school, I was working with adults and older people that were, way up in their 50s and stuff at Textile Machine Works. Kept busy, ended up graduating from Mountain State University in West Virginia, and I got a bachelor's degree in Administration of Justice. And my first stint for getting elected to public office was that I was a committee man in the 10th Ward, and that was back in the days of Bubu Leonardziak, Joe Kosminski. Everybody was on council at that particular time. I think Kosminski at that time was the mayor. And I then ended up running for the Reading School Board. I ran for other chairs in between that I did not win, but I never lost an election. I just didn't win them. I just kept moving on. And I ran for the Reading School Board back in 86, 87, I took the board. I was fortunate back then. I was the number one vote getter for the seat on the school board, which was interesting. I was still a really young guy. Yeah. I was in my 20s.
Yeah.
And I stayed on there and basically ran for district judge from there. It was a district justice position at that time. And I took office in 1982. And I bought property in the city of Reading. I have investments. I'm not a person that's loaded with money. I have mortgages on my properties. I raised three beautiful daughters, who I'm very proud of today, and I have seven grandchildren. I never left Reading. I'm only really living a block and a half away from where I was raised on South 9th Street. My parents had a restaurant called Scotty's, and it's just like your typical old restaurants that were put into narrow buildings, and they were good. And I could tell you all the places I worked. I just always felt like I had so much that I could give back to our city, because the city and its people, as I grew up, were very good to me.
Yes.
The orphanage. I've gone back to see Francis Hall. It's amazing how you remember certain things there. And that's always had a warm spot in my heart, because of the fact that that's where I got my base in religion and stuff. And I went through the gamut as any other Catholic young man. I was an altar boy, everything. And of course, I wanted to be a priest. And I'm like anyone else. I met a girl, and that was the end of the priesthood. But it was fun. And so it was a long journey that just seems like a blink of an eye. But when I look back on it, it seems like what's neat about life, I would tell you, is that the pictures that you have in your mind of where you were at certain times, or how you were growing up, what was in our downtown and what was in our city that's not there no more. But those thoughts never leave you, because when you grow up, especially back when I grew up, you weren't just living in a community, you were part of it. And so it's a lot of great things that I could tell you about Reading. I think one thing that probably will be unique with me, although you've had other mayors that were born and raised here too, but I certainly know what Reading was when I was growing up. I know where we are today, and I have a pretty good idea where I'd like to take us. And so I've been telling people through the campaign the things that I think that we could do, and I'm going to do my best to do them for you now. Yeah. And I thank all of you for coming out to vote for me. I want to tell you, we're going to have a great 4 years. And before we get started in this, before I forget, I'd like to invite you all down to City Hall on January the 4th at 10 o'clock. I should be getting sworn in. Haven't made up my mind if I can do it outside or if I'll do it inside City Hall. It depends on the amount of people that come. I've been getting a lot of people asking about it, so I'm trying to figure out what to do and exactly how to put it together, because it's not really my event. It's the event of the people of the city of Reading. And I'm just there as a service to you. So I'm trying to figure out how can I accommodate you, and hoping that a lot of you will come and take part in the swearing-in ceremony of your new mayor.
Wally, I've gotten to know you certainly a lot better in the last 2 weeks, having had a number of discussions with you. And I don't think I've ever said this to you, but I've said it to a lot of people about you. One of the things I'm struck by is that it's interesting. In government, a lot of times it's difficult for people to look at issues and to say, I've got to make a decision, I've got to move forward. And the one thing I'm struck with you is as a district justice of 22 years, you've got to make decisions. You've always had to make decisions. And I think that's going to be a skill and a strength that you're bringing to this office that's going to be very helpful for the city, and something that's going to be helpful for you. As a judge, you can't sit there and say, I really don't want to make this decision. I want to move it forward. You've got to make the decision. And you've had 22 years of experience with that right in front of you, and maybe it's a 51% decision that somebody's just got enough to say they're innocent or they're guilty, but you got to make the decision. And I think that's a skill that you're bringing to this office that I think is going to be very good for you. Having served in government, I see that in you.
Okay, well, thank you.
Yeah, the business of government is difficult, and I don't know how many citizens appreciate how difficult it is when you're looking at something, and there's a time frame that decision has to be made, and maybe you're not comfortable. Maybe you like to make decisions when it's 80% or 90%, or you know it's the right decision. But sometimes those decisions have to be made, and I think that's a real skill that you're going to bring to the table. I'm really happy about that. So, I also think, this is just my background in municipal management, and having spent a number of times in urban areas, I think we're at a really interesting crossroads for urban areas, especially in Pennsylvania, because they've been so neglected for years and years and years. And I think now citizens are starting to look at urban areas and cities like Reading, that if we can get some basic things organized and laid out, they become real cultural centers and places where people want to be. And I think that that gives you a really good opportunity as we move forward, that I think that, that urban areas are being reimagined and re-opportuned. And I don't know what your thoughts are about that, but I think it's a really good time right now to be coming in as a mayor of an urban area in Pennsylvania.
I think one of the greatest assets we have, obviously, you know, everybody talks about our mountains and the pagoda and our beautiful architecture and stuff, but the people themselves are really the assets of the city of Reading. Because, you know, if you remember where you came from, you can never go wrong, okay? And you you take a look at it, and I have some great hope for us in this sense. I don't see anything as really being complicated, okay? I'm the type of person that if somebody comes in, they ask me for something specific, I ask them, is this part of something big? And I like to see the whole picture before I make a decision on it. I don't piecemeal. I try to see the big picture and then try to feel how we can move ourselves along. One thing unique about urban development, especially in our city here, is that as opposed to being in boroughs and townships and regional things that you're doing, I really got to think about what do the people of the city of Reading want. Yeah. We're a large population. It shows 87,000, but I truly believe we're probably about 95,000, okay? And we have all different kinds of skills in our community. We have all different kinds of businesses. We have all different cultures that live together. And I love it. I just think the people, I, you know, every day, I just thank the people of City Reading for giving me the opportunity. Because I know I can take us where we need to go. And I talked in my campaign about getting a railroad here, doing a railroad museum. When I talk about the things I saw when I grew up, I find that the new people that are here, the new culture that's here, they came from railroads. I eat at the Boston restaurant almost every day, and it's changed hands now, but there was a Romanian family that was there. And I never knew that the father worked in the railroad in Romania, and so did all the rest of his family. And when he saw my brochure talking about the railroad, doing a railroad museum, he says, anything he can do. Restoration, anything that can be done. And I've heard it from people all over the city of Reading and Berks County that are looking for something. So I'm doing my best to try and bring a railroad to us here and a railroad museum. It started with the museum, and people said, are you just going to stop there? Can we go to New York? Can we go to Philadelphia? And I says, I guess we can do anything. We certainly can dream. And if we don't have hope and we don't have aspirations on what we want to do as a city or a community, then we really depend on the thoughts of others. And I'd rather think about the thoughts of the people that live here. So we're looking at that. I don't know if you have another question, but can you elaborate? Okay.
This is our quiet time to talk to the residents of the city, so I want you just to feel free to talk. I'm excited about the Railroad Museum. I think I told you that my... while my father was a pilot in the Marine Corps, and we grew up all over the country, my mother was from Bethlehem, and my grandfather was an engineer for the Reading Railroad in the Bethlehem Steel Yards. Yeah. And then my uncle ended up being an engineer for Conrail after Reading was consolidated into Conrail. So railroads are really steeped in my background, and I'm always confused why the city of Reading doesn't have a railroad when it's internationally known for its railroad. So I'm going to be interested to see how that process evolves, and I think it would be great for the city to have a museum.
Well, I have a lot. Well, thank you. We as a city want all the help we can get from everybody and anyone. We know there's naysayers out there and people that don't say it. But you know, in this journey that I did go through getting here, I found that everybody has their own little area that they're trying to control for money and contributions. And if they feel that, you know, you're coming along with something that somebody might want contributions for, it'll take from something else. But I'm going further than that. I'm trying to get outside of Berks County for funding. And in January and February, I'll be going to New York. I'll be going to Washington. I'm talking about a railroad that'll take us from here to New York and also to into Philadelphia. I've made appointments and meetings with people. I've had a great time. There's no one that says no to us, and there's not one person I've met anywhere that has not heard of the Reading Railroad. Okay?
It's an amazing story. I growing up, I just thought that Monopoly just decided that Reading would be the, you know, a neat name for a railroad, not realizing that the Reading Railroad went all the way down to Atlantic City, and all four of the railroads that are there are in Atlantic City, Pennsylvania Railroad included. So I just didn't know that. But, you know, when you get that kind of advertising where generations, you know about the Reading Railroad, that's an amazing story. It really is.
Well, even a museum. I mean, there's people who live in Wyomissing, there's people who live in Topton, there's people who live in here in Reading, in different parts of Reading that have complete train sets in their basement all year round.
Yeah.
And they put on their little gray hats and they're the engineers for the day. And it's men and women, okay? Not just men. And I've had so many people say they like to donate time, donate the cars that they have, the Lionel trains. I talked with you the one day.
Yeah.
And you had a Lionel train set and I told you you should still have it.
Yeah.
But there's a lot. People want to be involved. They just want to be part of something. But they want it to be real. They don't want it to be something where somebody comes along, and I don't mean this in any negative manner to anyone, and talks about what their dream is, but never asks you what yours is.
Right.
So this dream that I think we have, and I always say that as a people, started out with the thought of a museum, and it's the people of the city of Reading that started saying to me, what can we do? And then when I was on the telephone with a couple of people from New York, and I talked with a congressman, they said there's like 5 miles of rail track that we would have to replace, and they estimated $1 million a mile. $5 million to put a couple of rails in. I don't get it, but I guess, you know, this is the way the world is today. So we're looking for funding, we're looking for money, and we're going to get it. And but if I could just take you to the basic things. I think what I bring to the table is your new mayor, the one that you elected, are that the issues that I brought up are things that definitely affect you as people here in the city of Reading. Who wants to go to jail for victimless crimes? Okay? Parking tickets that are criminal. Parking tickets you can't even raise an appeal to the parking authority on. And they tell you that, well, you'll have to wait till you get a ticket from the district judge, citation. What they don't tell you is that when you get your ticket for the first 10 days, even up to 20 days, it's all civil, it's not criminal. They push you into the criminal process, okay? And I say they push you into the criminal process because I tried for many years to change the process that they have, but they were making too much money, okay? So my job is, you know, obviously to make sure that the city gets a balanced budget, but I don't want to do it on the backs on all the backs of the people in the city of Reading here. I want to figure out new ways that we can bring money into the city. Truancy, I'm going to sit with the superintendent. I keep saying to myself, we're going to make a meeting. I want to try and get them to stop doing citations, criminal citations on it, and offer more programs that children can get involved in to keep them interested in school. And I'd like to mirror a program in the city of Reading as they do federally, which is called Job Corps. I've contacted Home Depot, I've contacted Lowe's, I've contacted CVS, Rite Aid, different places, and I tried to mirror what the federal government does. The advantage we have is the federal government only offers you a degree that's a general equivalency degree, which is a GED, where we could offer a high school diploma if we incorporate it and work it within our school system. And then our schools don't lose the amount of money they get for each student that's there, but maybe we can get them into a workforce or into a program that they dream about. I remember as a judge, just about everybody I run into is a mechanic, the best mechanic you ever want to meet in this city. It used to make me wonder, you know, you drive down different alleys and stuff, and people are out closing up these garages because these guys are working on cars. But you know what? There's young kids in there working on cars. They're not on the street running around. Instead of closing them down, let's figure out how we can get them a license and how we can get them a real garage that they could be in. It's amazing what they do in the garages they are in and how they utilize all the space. And a lot of people say, well, I'm weak on different things. And I'm not weak on different things. What I am is I look at it, I'm compassionate, and I realize everybody's a human being. And there are a lot of things that are not available to us in the city of Reading that people are doing their best to create, and they get the job done, and without the help of government. A lot of your businesses that we have, our corner stores, our bodegas, doctor's offices, everything here. I mean, there's so many people I've met in my lifetime that never came to government and asked them for money, and they're surviving. And they pay the taxes in this town. They keep us alive. They take care of the people that are here. They take care of our children. And then I see all these millions of dollars that go into buildings that really aren't done by developers. They're done by guys that are building buildings and making money. And, you know, that all has to stop. We have to have a dream, or we have to have something. When I look at downtown Penn Street, I was watching the news tonight about, and I was on the computer, and saw that they're expecting 600,000 people that are going to come in to go to this hotel. But they're not coming to go to the hotel. They're coming to go to the Santana Center. They're coming to watch the Royals to see if we're going to get better groups in that will attract more. You know, we compete with Allentown. Allentown gets the really great shows. We have to figure out a way that the Santana can basically start to get some of those shows and show an interest here. And we have to start, if we want to fill the Santana Arena, I believe it's 22,000 seats there or something, I'm not sure. Then you have to look also at the great culture of people that are here that would fill that if you brought the right groups in.
Right.
So we just can't appease, we can't appease just those who want Reading to look like what they want it to look like and what they wanted to also at the same time offer them. I want it to offer everybody, including our city. You got a captive audience of probably about 95,000 people that live around Penn Street. And they all want to come to shows. They all want to do things. But we don't want to be fooled by anyone.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of things that I could tell you that I'm learning as I go along. And at this particular point, you know, as mayor, I'm going to do my best to inspire those people that I know have made a fortune off this town rather than attack them. And tell them to start helping us as a people rather than helping themselves, okay? And I'll look into your camera to the people that are out there. For many, many years, you've known me. And one thing I've always tried to do is I know in a court, I can't have two people living feeling as though one person leaving feeling as though, well, they lost, that they're not a good person. I try to show the difference between you still have a court of law, we have rules, regulations that you run by, and that we run our city by in our country. And at the same time, I want you to feel when you left here that you got a fair shake and that there was nothing here, there was no prejudice or anything. That's what I bring with myself to City Hall. I don't intend to be sitting fighting with council. I don't have time for the drama. Okay, but what I do have is I have 4 years. And in those 4 years, everything that I've promised the city of Reading, I know I can get just about every one of them done for sure. Okay, three quarters of them done for sure. I'm going to make sure that I can get it all done for you. And as I go along, I'm learning new ideas still. And I'm running into people that may not have agreed with us and what we want to see in downtown Reading or what we want to see in our communities. But now they're coming on board. They understand it. It's not about Wally. It's about the people of the city of Reading. And this is not a mayor that you have to call mayor. You can call me Wally. I want to do the best job. And I think that that's what the people of the city of Reading are looking for. I don't want people to violate our citizens. I don't want laws that violate us just strictly to make money. And I want to put together programs. I said through the campaign, I want to lift you and help you, not push you and hurt you. And I really am going to bring that. And I know the newspaper wrote an article one time where it said that I'll fight anybody for what I want. That's not what I said. What I said was, I'll fight anyone that's against what the people want, and I'll battle them, okay? And I think things are starting to change with the paper, too. They're starting to realize that their function is to write the news, not make it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll stand firm on that. I don't care if they never put me in the paper. What I do care about is what every person out there's life means to them living here in the city of Reading. I've started my inroads. I talked with the district attorney. One of the things that I had on my program when I passed it out was on public safety. I said, everybody says, you know, you have to have more police, whatever. Well, if we can't afford the police, we got to figure out some other way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And my thoughts are this. The more cameras we get, it's a great deterrent to crime. Most of your crimes today, violent crimes, are solved by what they find. People have cameras at their homes, the works. People are afraid to let the police have the camera or have the information that was on there. So I want to have a community of people that basically, where our police department becomes more community-oriented. And if somebody gives us a tip, don't take and tell the neighbor that somebody reported them. Actually look at it. But I don't want to waste my time either, okay? And I don't want to waste the people's time. I don't want people calling up because they don't dislike their neighbor reporting something and not identifying themselves. If it's nothing serious, I'm not sending anybody there. If you give us your name, we'll go. Okay, right. But we want to call you back the same way when you order a pizza, you order Chinese food. They take the number to make sure you're really there, okay? Because I've seen as a district judge, a lot of people like to harass each other for stupid reasons. And our police department's more so, we need them there for the safety of everybody, especially the good people, okay? To protect us if something doesn't happen that would be wrong. I've had just about every part of government in my court. I've seen the best of it. I've seen the not so best of it. I've never seen the worst, though. I can tell you that. I've just seen people who bid on this and bid on that with no qualifications for those jobs. And I can remember about 10 years ago, I said, why don't you put, there has to be something that tells you what you need to be in a certain position and not so much worrying about what a union thinks or says. We just can't dump people or have them because of the fact that something may have happened to their job where they want to move into another job that they have no skills in at all, okay? So I've seen that start to change because enough people were arguing about it. So you named a department, and I've had that department come to me, okay? And I've never found bad people in government, especially in the workers, okay, that are there. They're just doing their jobs, and I know a lot of people in Reading are really upset that more than the majority of people that work in City Hall don't live here. But it doesn't mean they don't care about us. What it does mean is this. Let me sort out who's bad, okay? Mm-hmm. And I'll do my best to inspire them to do better. And if they won't, then they shouldn't work for us. We don't want people that hurt us. We want people that want to be part of our community. Downtown, I'd like to see, as I told you before, I'd like to see a railroad museum. I'd like to see a children's museum, which is a hands-on museum. I've talked to different people that will help us with that. I've talked to different stores about outlets that used to be in Reading, that we might be able to provide stores for them downtown for outlets. A lot of people are going to urban development. They're trying to get out of strip malls, okay? And they want to become part of a city. I think people will love sleeping at the Doubletree. I think they'd love sleeping also at the Abraham Lincoln. When you write the Doubletree, you write Absolutely. A story about the Abe Lincoln. They're both great, okay? And they're all drawing from the same pot, though, okay? And then you have the hotel that's over the Penn Street Bridge. They were getting a lot of our traffic. You have the one that's over on Park Road. They were getting a lot of our traffic. So it's not about one, it's not a hotel saving us. It's human beings that save us. These are just buildings that are built. They get their 5 years of credit, okay? Where they get the credit benefits. And once they're up, then that's when you really find a measure of the building. They either walk away and they leave us with it. But remember this, I want you to know this, and this is not kidding with the people of City Reading. Every development that's put together with community development, block grant money, with community development, loans, HUD, whatever, we as a people in the City of Reading, we pledge our taxes to that project. If that project fails, we pay it. So we really want to start looking at people that aren't building buildings. I keep saying that. And I will fight for you for everything and anything that we as a people deserve. And it's not for me, it's for us. And for the next 4 years, what you lost in 18 years, I'd like to try to get us back, okay? So I'm going to work very, very hard for you. And I'm going to make life a lot easier for you. You'll see that day one. One of the things, if I may keep talking,
sure.
that I'd like to do is, when I was out campaigning, I thought the city of Reading itself is the biggest graffiti violator, okay, of anyone in our town. Everywhere you go, there's stickers on doors that were shut down because they had no water. I don't want to shut down water. I'm not turning off water. And the water authority says, you know, well, why? the big thing is it affects more than just the person you're turning off the water for a bill. We can lien properties. Properties that are owned by landlords, we can lien those properties also. We can get the money, but we have to inspire people to feel good about living here. Everybody right now, we're like, there's groups of people that are out there that are scrapping, doing the best they possibly can to stay alive. So they're trying to pay Peter, you know, to meet Paul, whatever, however that phrase used to go years ago. But there's a lot of suffering going on. There's a lot of people that are hurting. And one thing that we should always make sure that we have is the most essential thing in life, water. And people need to bathe, and people need water, and we don't want people taking showers once a week, okay? We want to make the water rates right. I have a good friend of mine, Bill Murray, who's been involved in my campaign that basically knows just about, I've never met a guy that knows so much about water. Probably you at the same time are the same. And there's so many things we can be doing with the Water Authority and with that product that we have. All those things will start to come out. You know, when I give my speech on January 4th, I want you to come for it, because I'm going to explain where we're going. And when I say where we're going, not my dream, your dream, I'm just going to facilitate it, and it's our dream. And I think you're going to feel good about where you're going to be in 4 years. And the most important thing is you don't have to wait 4 years to get there. I'm going to make life better for you day one. So I'm going to have all the stickers removed from all the buildings. Nobody wants them there. I mean, it destroys blocks. People can't even get insurance on their buildings with a stickered building next door. So I'm going to get them down, get together a list of all the properties, the pictures, where they are, and work on that. And start to put together programs. I do want to tell you, and I'm telling council and everybody, I don't believe in land banking, especially the way they put together that ordinance. I don't think the two people should have the right to all the properties that are out there, and then a board of realtors gets it. We've got lots of investors and people that live in apartments now that got a couple of bucks in their pocket if they like the opportunity to move into a house and start to develop it. And I do want to make community development money available through all our neighborhoods. And I'm putting together a program that we can work it out of City Hall. But I still, at the same time, want to embrace and ask all those who have developed in our town, all those who have made good money in this city, and all of you out there that don't pay taxes on your properties. And one day, you know, what I'm asking you is, I just would like to send you a message. It's good to step back and tell you how much you're doing for us, but at the same time, we're in a position where, especially with me as a mayor, I know exactly what you do, and I know what you do pay in taxes, if you pay any. And when I watch different programs and I watch the news tonight and they talk about how much money's coming in, I also look at the structure of the companies that run these things. And some may get embarrassed. But I think that what I'd like to do is, before we get to the embarrassment, why don't you sit down with the representative of the people of the city of Reading and let's make our town work, but become part of it. Just don't make it all and take it with you. We need your help now. And also the ones who have tax deferments. We could use a couple of years of taxes if you'll help us. I'm not asking for me, I'm asking for the people of this city.
You know, Wally, I came to you to ask you to come here tonight because I wanted you to have an opportunity to talk to the residents, not as an election process, but as on the eve of your tenure. And I'm really happy that you saw the opportunity to do it. I think people are seeing you in a way that maybe those that don't know you have not met you that way. I've gotten a chance to talk to you a little bit and understand that. And I have a lot of hope for where you're taking this city. Keep your vision high. Keep that goal. Don't ever let go of the goals. And I think the city is really sitting on the precipice of something very special. So I want to thank you for coming tonight. Okay. I want you to know that CELG is here to serve the city of Reading as well as Berks County. And all you need to do is ask, and we're happy to help you.
I want to thank you for being on my transition team, too. And I want to thank Chuck Gallagher, Sunilda Tejada, John Cromer, I think his name was. There was a minister that was there, Steve McCracken. Steve, I never can say his last name, but owns Queen City Diner. All good people. Dr. Sotomayor, who I invited to also be on that transition team. You all have gotten together and have given me a blueprint of where good people that work in City Hall still want our city to go and have been waiting for the chance to offer their ideas of what we can do, and that's helped me tremendously. So I want to thank you and all the other members of the team that were involved, and I really got to know you from this transition team and all the good people that are involved in it. You've helped me to see other people in a different light, okay? I just don't think about the people of the city of Reading. I think about all the people that come into Reading, too. And I do think about everybody that works here, okay? And I want to make this a town that all of us love. And it's people say that government's complex. No, it isn't. Government's simple. It's a blueprint. I even said to you one day, get me the blueprint of the city government. And what we find is that it's people in government. But I don't want to hold your next guest up. I just want to say to everybody, please, if you have time, come down and be part of your government by showing up for Inauguration Day, which is on January the 4th, and it's at 10 o'clock. Hopefully, you'll be outside. If it snows, I'll love it. So, okay? Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you for
Thanks again, Wally. I really appreciate you stopping by. We'll take a break now, and I'll transition our guests. Thank you.
If you listen to the critics, if you listen to your own doubts and call them reasons, you may never find the drive to go back to school. But a little change in direction, a new perspective, and the right program may make your successful new path a reality. The Accelerated Degree Program at Albright College. Start your degree or complete your degree one night a week in as little as 2 years. Albright College, a different way of thinking.
Welcome back to this month's show of local government in Berks. I want to change gears a little bit. We've had a nice, quiet little fireside chat with Mayor-elect Wally Scott, but now I have the pleasure of bringing on two of my associates at Albright College to talk about a new program, and it's one that's very dear to my heart. As a Marine Corps brat, I grew up in the military, and it wasn't such easy times back when I was growing up. It was during the Vietnam era, and veterans weren't treated very well, and neither were people who were actually in the military or kids that were in the military. So today, I just am so happy and thankful for my father and my mom who had to go through that process to see how people treat our veterans and the key that we have to helping them out. And so now I want to talk to you a little bit about a program that Albright College has for veterans. And I want to welcome two of my guests, Tyshana Rosado and also Tracy Gray Hayes. Tyshana is the AmeriCorp Vista Veterans Service Coordinator.
Yes.
And Tracy is the Associate Director for the Accelerated Degree Program at Reading. So Thank you both for coming to my show tonight.
You're welcome.
And I look forward to talking to people a little bit about what's going on. So Tracy, why don't you give us a little bit of a background about why this is a program at Albright College and what we're trying to accomplish.
Certainly. Thank you again, Paul, for having us here tonight. Albright College's accelerated degree program allows adults to pursue a Bachelor of Science degree in the evening in one of seven different majors. So adults 21 years of age or older are able to attend class one night a week at our main campus in Reading and also throughout Pennsylvania. Albright offers the accelerated degree program in the Lehigh Valley, as well as Dauphin, Delaware, Montgomery, and Lancaster counties. Albright's proud to have a growing veteran population. Last year, around this time, we began discussing ways to assist veterans, active duty military, and their families to become aware of their educational benefits and ways to utilize them. And that's basically the beginning of our Joining Forces program at Albright. We were aware of opportunities with AmeriCorp Vista, so we submitted an application, it was around this time last year. In the beginning of 2015, we were contacted by AmeriCorps, and we were made aware that our application was approved and accepted. So we did begin the Albright College Joining Forces program. We actually had applicants from all over the Northeast apply for this grant-funded position, and we were fortunate enough that Tyshana accepted our offer. And Tyshana has been serving as the Veteran Service Coordinator for almost 5 months now.
So Tyshana, let's switch gears and why don't you tell our viewers a little bit about what the purpose of the program is that you're now working with?
Well, the mission is to develop an education model that allows veteran service members and their families to understand what benefits are available to them and how to access those benefits here in Reading and Berks County, as well as the support necessary to succeed so that they can use higher education benefits as a path to economic stability.
So I'm really proud that Albright College has this program available, but it's really not just for Albright College, right?
No. I'm as a AmeriCorp Vista, Albright brought me on to work with the whole county, and I'm bring the student veterans from our college to network with Alvernia, Penn State, Berks, Kutztown, and Berks Technical Institute. So the whole greater Reading area. So we're here to basically help give resources, not just educational resources. People can come to us to find out what other resources are available to veterans.
That's really important. I mean, I appreciate the fact that you're located in our building in Albright, but you're really there for everybody. You're there for the veterans. You're there for their families.
Yes.
If you're a viewer and you're hearing this program, don't feel like if you come to our building on Albright campus that's where you have to go. That's not what the program is about. It's really to knock down the walls and the barriers to higher education.
Exactly.
Excellent. Okay. So there's a couple of things that have been developed with Albright College as a result of some of this work. Tell me what military-friendly designation means for ADP and for Albright College.
Well, there's an organization called Victory Media out there, and they have a very long survey. It took a couple months to get information from all over the college so that they can find out what we're doing. And if military-friendly designation means that we have a liaison or a service director for individuals to come to. There's centralized services for veterans, military members, and their families. There's counseling services available, and it's also we give credit for things that individuals did while they were in the military, life credits for other training that they may have received on the job. And we also are just here to make sure that they have a place to come and have somebody to talk to outside of just going to finding out about their financial benefits.
So. You're a veteran too, right?
Yes, I am.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I was in the Army. It's been, that was back in the 90s. I was doing signal. I was doing communications, working with telephone lines out in the field. And once I got out of the military, I went to the workforce and later on was able to use my veteran benefits to get education. And I got some experience working as a veteran service coordinator while I was at Harrisburg Area Community College. So that helped prepare me for what I'm doing here.
So if a veteran calls you, he's going to be talking to somebody who's really been down those road that road before.
Exactly.
And you'll be able to talk the talk and walk the walk and really help him.
Yes, it's not always easy to come back into a environment where you're you're older than the rest of the students, and that's one of the great things about our program and some of the other programs that cater to adult students. You know that you can come in and feel like you're right at home.
So. Outstanding. Okay. There's another designation that I think that people in Berks County and the city of Reading are interested in, and that is that Albright College is a yellow ribbon participant. What does that mean?
Actually, Albright has been a yellow ribbon participant for a number of years. The yellow ribbon program is federally funded, and it allows Albright to work with the VA to help cover educational costs that exceed the benefits awarded by the post 9/11 GI Bill.
You need to reinforce that. So somebody who's looking at going to higher education, they have a certain amount of benefits that they get from the GI Bill. Mm-hmm. But this program assists them in meeting some needs so they can continue their education, whether they have the money there or not. They can try to find sources where they can get additional funding. Is that correct?
Exactly.
So let's be really clear. I mean, don't let money be an issue. At least explore the avenue and see if you can get to higher education through some of this support that's there. So
absolutely, and that's where Tyshana comes in. And like you said, she's available to help Albright students as well as students attending colleges or thinking about attending colleges throughout Berks County.
Yes. Outstanding. Tyshana, you're planning a big event early next year. Do you want to tell our viewers, you know, what that is and where it is? And
Yes, we'll have a symposium. Tentatively, it's February 19th, and it's the first Berks County Student Veterans Symposium, Boots to Books in Business. And it's for personal and professional development. You can come and have information on how to take your military experience and turn it into regular experience on your resume and things like that. So we're looking for anyone who is a family of a student veteran, interested in being a student veteran, or wants to network with student veterans. So.
Tyshana, how do they find your program? Do you have a phone number? Do you have website? Well, how do we find it?
On our Albright College Accelerated Degree program, we do have a page that has all my information. But my email address is trosado, TROSADO, at albright.edu. And you can send me an email, and I'll get in contact with you.
And Rosner Hall is located at the corner of Rockland Street and 13th Avenue, right here on campus at Albright. And you're welcome to stop by the building, and you'll see Tracy and Tyshana and myself smiling and laughing and making a lot of noise as we do. Tracy, what a little bit. I'm going to surprise you a little bit here, but mm-hmm. but you've worked in local government before, right?
Yes, several years ago, actually, my first job. I'm fortunate to be a graduate of Albright College. I graduated in 1993, and I worked, when I finished school here, I went home to New Jersey and obtained a job with my municipality. I was an office supervisor with a division of the health department.
So we've had some little discussions about local government and just some fun with that.
But, yes, absolutely.
So anyway, as we close the program, I just think it's important for everybody, if you know of a veteran, or if you have a child who's a veteran, or you are a veteran yourself, please reach out. There is higher education available for you, and it's a tremendous opportunity. So I'd like to close out 2015. With the last installment of Local Government at Berks, I'd like to extend warm wishes for a happy Hanukkah, blessed Merry Christmas and a happy and blessed New Year. Once again, thank you to Albright College for all of the support given to CELG and the municipalities in the County of Berks. And we'll see you again on our next program on February 9th, 2016. Have a great holiday season. Thank you very much.
If you listen to the critics, if you listen to your own doubts and call them reasons, you may never find the drive to go back to school. But a little change in direction, a new perspective, and the right program may make your successful new path a reality. The Accelerated Degree Program at Albright College. Start your degree or complete your degree one night a week in as little as 2 years. Albright College, a different way of thinking.